It's such a great day that I'm going to tape some more. Previous video ended with suddenly it just the software error stopped working, and it's the Holy Spirit. That Spirit deciding that no further, because I was having trouble with my voice, and I think it was I had said enough, and so miraculously poof, stopped working. So that's great. Now a little bit later here, we're able to say a little more. Again, we have no choice but to hear the truth, which is really the mood of repentance. Hearing the truth is the mood of repentance, which means changing your mind, changing what you're wishing for, changing what you desire. We have been desiring to be greater than God, actually. And then we think we've arranged a competition with God whereby we're going to be able to determine, you know, which is greater, God the Father, God the Son. God the prime creator, God the prime created, which is greater. And we think we've arranged this competition called time, space, process, and form. And we believe that there's these human beings, that there's autonomy taking place, or potential autonomy, or the incomplete autonomy that is on its way towards completion, and that will determine the winner between Spirit and God. So, looking at it this way, this is how we look at it. This is the big picture. It's called the big picture way of looking at the situation. And we, in the mood of repentance, meaning setting down our arrogance, we're able to hear what's being said, and we just say, ah, yes, this is true. Thank you for, I thank myself for listening and hearing. And we're not tripped up by terminology here. We're not tripped up by terminology. This is one of the great shortcuts of why this saves so much time, is there's a lot of terminology that has been generated throughout this whole debacle of this imaginary contest and this belief that we're producing some progress, some momentum towards autonomy, towards deciding the outcome of this contest. We feel we can't do anything. We have to wait for the outcome. That's part of the deal we think we've made with God, is we're bound to the outcome of all this is then determines what our fate, what happens to us, and what happens to God. So we have no choice, we think, but to wait for the outcome. So that's what we're doing. We're waiting, saying, come on, where's the outcome? We want closure. We want to... There is no outcome. How can there be an outcome to perfect freedom, which is what we are? There isn't any autonomy taking place at all, actually. It's a dream of autonomy, but the dream is being dreamed entirely by the dreamer. So we just recognize this, accept it, and we believe that hearing this, accepting it, deepens our repentance, and this will lead to spontaneously simply revealing what's already there, like we're using a broom to dust, to sweep the dust away, and when you do, you see the floor better and better and better. It's already there. We don't have to make Spirit Spirit. We don't have to stop Spirit from producing autonomy. It's not producing autonomy at all. So we don't get tripped up over verbiage and words, no matter where they come from, all right? Because we keep it very simple here, very simple. And it's the mood of repentance. It's the full stop and the wow. We have our practice, okay? So we're not nitpicking, as some have done in the past, because that's the way they went about it, which is fine. But we're going about it in what we feel is a simpler, more streamlined way. Because all those considerations have as their premise, how are we withdrawing from autonomy? How are we slowing it down? How are we, disinvesting it? How are we doing this and this? We're not, there's no how to it, because we're not doing that, actually. We're not producing autonomy. We're not producing any momentum. We're not doing anything in that regard at all. So it's best away to stay away from excessive terminology. Try to keep it simple. And continue to state the unadorned, unembellished, unlaborated truth without outsmarting yourself. Of course, there's the pragmatic continuity fear issue, which has to be recognized. We have to evaporate this. So we practice seeing the truth, then the full stop in the wow of seeing the truth, and then going back towards working towards seeing the truth again, and then asserting it, stating the truth over and over and over and over and over. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Haven't been any changes. Have not been any changes. So rather than try to tackle all this terminology, we just say we have what we need here. We have everything we need, which is recognizing all of this is a dream, and it's totally non-autonomous dream. It's a totally dependent dream. It's dependent entirely upon our desire that it arise, and that all of this is sheer arrogance. It's nothing but sheer arrogance. There isn't any outcome to be determined whatsoever. And then we're just working towards just relaxing into this. That's all. And the relaxation into it is a mental relaxation where we feel less and less scared, less and less frightened, less and less scared about it. And we just keep reminding ourselves that there's nowhere to fall to because we never gained any height of progress at all. So spirit really doesn't need to engage in any debates or fine nitpicking. Doesn't need to. It just needs to accept and realize that indeed this is nothing but an attempt to camouflage our arrogance, existence, time, space, process, and form. So we don't struggle with too much words. And there had been an accumulation throughout history in the various traditions. This world has a number of traditions throughout history. You go back history, you go, you know, the shamanism, then, you know, Zoroastrianism, Jainism, you have Hinduism, and you have Buddhism, you have Christianity, you have Islam, you have also like Shintoism, and Judaism, right? And there's some other ones too. And out of that, out of those traditions comes so much verbiage. You have Gnosticism, yeah. And there was that other one, there was a dualistic one. Anyway, so much verbiage, and so many terms, and so much technology, and so much philosophy, spiritual technology, so much philosophy, so many different ways of going about it, so many big words, compound words, this and then this and that, and many different schools of branches of each of these things. And and you have all the pagan religions too, all the pagan religions and Mithraism, and you get massive amounts of words, and everybody's trying to, different schools each coming up with their own interpretations, their own spin, all of this. So you can feel absolutely lost trying to dig through all that looking for the truth. And the great thing about this here is that we have a fresh, unencumbered truth here. Which is always possible. It's always possible to get a very fresh take on it. Where we're not weighted down by all of these different schools and disagreements between the schools and then the nitpicking over, is it this or is it this or is this, is this, you know, all this kind of stuff. Don't need that. Don't need some scholar to come along and win a debate and say, okay, this is right, we've won the contest. Whatever is the truth will stand revealed, naturally revealed, once we set our arrogance down. That's it. And reality doesn't need to be described. Reality doesn't need an answer. It's not, there's no questions in it. So it doesn't need an answer. We don't need to come up with any answers in that way at all. We don't need to develop a systemic explanation, exposition, epistemology, what do you call it, ontology, or some philosophical words describing, you know, this is this, 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 this. We don't need to. Reality stands revealed. It's already there. So just let it be revealed. Let it be revealed. And it's really not something that can be described conceptually because it doesn't have any opposite. And really, explanations and concepts are based on opposites, understanding comparisons and relativity and comparisons and differences, etc. There's nothing in reality that's different from reality. So there's no way you can speak of it in conceptual terminologies, you know, without it being rather awkward. So it will just be revealed by itself. It's already there. Now, is it being hidden, obscured? No, actually it's not. The belief that it is being hidden and obscured is our delusion. Are there defilements? No, there are no defilements, actually. That's a delusion. There's nothing defiling reality. There's nothing obscuring reality whatsoever. See, what we did is we imagine that we arrogated to God that God has to have get into a contest with us to decide who's true, what is truth. Is reality perfect or is it imperfect? And we're saying it's imperfect, and we think that God's saying it's perfect, and we thought we're going to have a contest to decide the outcome so there wouldn't be any conflict between us, and we'll both have to agree to the outcome. And we believe that there's this contest and that there's this autonomous force that is somehow objective that is going to decide the outcome. Now, but God isn't in any contest. Reality is not in any contest. Perfection is not in any contest. Perfection is still perfect. Everything is still functioning absolutely perfectly. There's no stains. There's no defilements. There's no obscuration at all, actually. But what we're doing is we're believing that God had to suspend perfection. In order to enter into this agreement, a contest, we had to say, okay, we're not going to assert that reality is imperfect. We'll suspend that. But God, you have to suspend the perfection, your belief in the perfection of reality. So we're in this kind of like abyss-like. We imagine this sort of abyss-like where reality is neither real nor unreal. It's just we don't know what it is yet to be determined. It's yet to be determined, and so we believe that there's an abyss there, but there's no abyss there. There's no abyss, and the idea that's yet to be determined by the so-called objective autonomous time-space process and form determining the outcome is yet there's nothing yet to be determined. Nothing's autonomous. So there can't possibly be anything obscuring or defiling reality or truth at all. It's that we just believe that there's this an abyss, and there's this autonomous action taking place, and this we have to wait for this outcome to take place. So in this waiting, it's easy for us to think that somehow reality is being obscured, or we have to do something to remove defilements or anything like that. There's nothing we need to do, actually. There's no defilements to remove. There's no obscuration to remove at all. We just need to stop waiting, realizing there isn't any autonomous action taking place. And this is all a dream of spirit. This is... This is what spirit is desiring. This is what is arising. Times the illusion of time, space, process, and form. The idea that it's somehow autonomous is the illusion. That's the illusion. It's not an illusion. It's just our wish to believe. We want to believe it, but it's not taking place. God did not suspend the perfection of reality at all, but we believe it has been suspended. Just as like we believe that the non-perfection has been suspended. So both being suspended, we think there's just this abyss, and the loser is going to fall into this abyss of this contest. So we want to feel like we're doing something. You say, oh yeah, there's defilements, there's stains, we have to remove those. You know, there's nothing that has to be removed. We just have to stop waiting for an outcome. There isn't any outcome to take place. There's nothing autonomous taking place. So how can there be an outcome? Everything is taking place in the now, always. And it's exactly what we want to take place. There's no such thing as an outcome. It's an autonomous outcome. Like we say, whoa, I didn't expect that. You know, that's autonomous. That just happened to me. You know, nothing ever happens to us. So there is no contest. So by looking at it this way, we just cut through, you know, just all the speculations that have arisen, really. And they're not needed. They're really not needed. And most people are used to using a lot of these props and crutches and wheelchairs to go along. And now we're saying just get up and walk. Get up and walk. Or at least stand up. Get out of the wheelchair. Put the crutches. Set the crutches. Lean the crutches up against the somewhere and realize you can walk. Start walking. So reality will stand revealed as soon as we stop waiting. And we keep waiting because we think the loser gets an abyss, you see. And we feel the only way we can win is to get an outcome. To prove that we were right, that reality wasn't perfect, that autonomy can so that we can that there's a process that leads to total autonomy from spirit, from reality, that it's self-sustaining, it doesn't need reality, and then that we prove that reality wasn't perfect. You see, we think, well, then we're greater than God, and then God will fall into the abyss. But there is no abyss. There is no abyss. We just imagined again that in order to have this contest, God had to make a deal, and God was going to suspend the belief in perfection. We would suspend the belief in imperfection, and we wouldn't know. Reality would have there wouldn't we wouldn't know what it is. It's yet to be determined. Yet to be determined. So an abyss. There's no abyss. God never entered into any agreement with us whatsoever. We arrogated this to God, saying that God has to agree to this. And the terminology, we want something to happen, even if it's getting better. You know, if it's, you know, there's nothing we have to do at all. Stop waiting. Just realize, wow. There's no abyss. There's no contest. There's no outcome to be determined. None of that is happening. That was just, this is our projected misperception on the dream that we're having. We're thinking the dream is dreaming itself. It's not. Now we can have all these puppets mouthing here. Oh, this, all this stuff's happening to me. Oh, it's a dream figure, like a puppet, and putting words in the puppet's mouth, as if that somehow constitutes a genuine experiencing of the puppet. The puppet's not experiencing anything. The body's not experiencing anything. It's the mind that's experiencing everything. It's the mind that's telling itself that there's this so-called autonomous activity taking place between bodies. So we have our own terminology here, our own emphasis here. We don't need to graft this into any tradition at all, actually. Doesn't require it. And really, if there's any explanation, it's those who have made it more complicated. Say, why did you need to make it so? Why did you feel you need to make it so complicated? I mean, that's what we don't really need to ask that question. We know. It's continuity fear, and you know, over this abyss, fear of the abyss, continuity fear, and all of this trying to be the author of our salvation, when in fact we've never left perfection. You know, trying to get free of some autonomy, and trying to, you know, like, we think of autonomy as something that's been, is growing. We feel we have to cut down the tree of autonomy and pull it up by the roots and prevent it from growing. No, there's never been any autonomy. Just like in a dream. It's like having the people in a dream that you're dreaming do all sorts of work in the dream, saying you need to cut down these trees and do this, in order to reduce the autonomy of the dream. There isn't any autonomy of the dream. So none of the dream figures have to do anything to prevent autonomy, to lessen it, to bring it to a stop, to defeat it. None of that has to take place. What has never happened and never can happen doesn't need to be defended against or dealt with in any way. So really there's nothing to be dealt with except pragmatically our continuity fear. And this is, you know, a fear of the abyss or a fear of a non-abyss. You know, it's like, wow, perfection. I don't know if I'm ready to accept it again. And I'm so used to believing in an abyss here, as if somehow perfection needs to be restarted. You see, this is where our fear maybe comes from, is not only the abyss, but we say, oh my gosh, perfection has been suspended for all this for so long, and now it needs to be restarted. I don't know how to restart it. I'm not sure what am I going to be like when restart. Perfection doesn't need to be restarted. It never stopped. God never entered into any agreement with us, with Spirit. So, yeah, it's been, perfection has been present all along. It's never stopped. It's never been diminished. We don't need to restart it. We don't need to clean it up. We don't need to remove defilements. We don't need to remove obscuration. We're just misinterpreting, you know. That's not a real obscuration. It's an intentional arrogance. There isn't any blockage, actually. There's no darkness. There's no darkness where reality is obscure. Now, the fear of the abyss and fear that we have to restart reality, all this, then this generates delay. And, of course, we don't want to admit that we're delaying. So what we do is we oftentimes talk over nitpicking, you know, spiritual, you know, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin sort of discussions. Is it this or is it this? Is it this? Is it this? Can you look at it? And this is delay. This is delay. It's born of fear. So in order to really cut the delay short, it's better to look at the big picture and recognize, oh, I don't really need to worry about, you know, all that nitpicking is, you know, that's just a symptom of continuity fear, which is a symptom of the fear of the abyss, as well as the fear of starting up perfection again, as if it has to be restarted. A fear of, like, feeling we lost the contest to God. Remember, there was never any contest, so how can we be losers? It's not possible for us to be losers, because there's never any contest. Truth is never something that is being contested. So, but our fear, we want to think that we don't want to think we're afraid. The thing with fear is we try to misperceive that and say, no, I'm not afraid. I just need to stop here and then find an excuse. Why did you stop? You know, why do we stop? Oh, well, we need to look at the definition of luminous mind, and what does it really mean? Does it mean this? Is it this? Is it this? And you go through, you spend a lifetime of entanglements of different, what is it? What do we really mean? This, you know, what do we mean by this term, this concept? What do we mean by this? It's better to just admit that you stop because of continuity fear and the wow factor. Stop because of the wow factor. The wow factor is the elation you're getting towards success, and then the continuity fear that arises, saying, wow, I don't know if I'm ready for this. The two together is the wow factor, and we say it's better just full stop in the wow. Why just stop? It's just wow. This is just tremendous that I realize, you know, the absolute, that I don't need to do anything. And just hearing all this, it's a wow. This is a much easier approach. There's a lot less delay in this. So instead of engaging in philosophical discussions, we engage in full stop in the wow here. And see, that's the difference between this practice and many others. Now, some certainly engage in that in various ways, right? But we have it front and center here in this practice. Front and center, it's full stop in the wow. We're walking together in the wow, meaning this is our practice, and this is very fast, direct practice. It doesn't fool around with. We don't waste time spinning our wheels too much here. But we have to actually do this. And you see, if you just full stop in the wow, no concepts, then it's easier to get started again, right? You're not entangled to say, well, I can't get going again until I resolve all this, you know, this discussion or whatever. Now, there's no discussion taking place. We realize we're just temporarily pausing because we're just reverberating with, oh, wow, this is tremendous. I just feel so, you know, liberation is here now. Wow. So close. You feel the closeness of it. So don't engage in concepts, and then it's easier to get going again. You don't have to think, well, did I resolve something? Did I make some progress? No, you're not trying to make progress in the wow. It's happening of itself as you get used to it, as you get familiar with recognizing how close you are, actually. In fact, you've never gone anywhere. You never deviated from truth at all. Arrogance is not a deviation, it's non-causative entirely. You can't change reality, so there's no deviation from reality at all, actually. It's impossible. So, you don't have to make progress as you sit in the wow, as you get familiar with how you feel. That is the progress. It's not a conceptual progress in the wow. It's a feeling. You're getting used to being so close, wow. And then once that, you know, you get used to it and you settle into it, then it's easier to continue to recognize that you're already there. You're already there. That's how close you are. You're already there. And of course, by close, what we do is we keep turning it into an outcome. So that always put outcomes always in the future, right? But remember, there is no contest. There is no autonomy. There is no to be determined laterness. There is no outcome whatsoever. None. None whatsoever. We're just projecting that upon everything, actually. Even claiming it's some big plan designed by God, you know, this whole thing. It's not. We're dreaming it. It's our design, our dream. But it's a design that has no momentum, has no reality to it at all. Everything is still completely a non-autonomous, simply expressing our production wishes, our production desires. Nothing, there's nothing bound at all. There's nothing autonomous to separate from perfect freedom at all taking place. So when we say we're close, we're still waiting for an outcome. The ultimate realization is there is no outcome to wait for. So we might say, to use the assertion power of practice, yes, I already know that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I am already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. So this really brings the whole, everything into play. Yes, I already know. This is the knowing of reality, that I'm already seeing. This is the, speaking of healed perception, seeing as perception, knowing as reality, seeing as perception. So seeing is still an illusion, but it's the final, healed perception is the final aspect of this whole arrogance, that it's like healed, it's like repentance instead of arrogance. It's repentance. So yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. So saying this, it brings everything into play. The fear of the abyss, we're recognizing. You know, no, there is no abyss. There is no contest. There is no abyss. There is no outcome we need to thwart. There isn't anything at all happening. Everything is just an expression of our moment-by-moment freedom. There's nothing autonomous taking place at all. So yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I am already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. So seeing this is the final, you know, vestige of, it's the echo of arrogance. It and ultimately that was let go of too. Because the idea, reality doesn't need to see itself. Reality doesn't need to see that there is no outcome. It doesn't need to see this. But we, because of our continuity fear, we have this pragmatic need to see this. First, I can see, yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. We see it reasonably. We see it spiritually. We see it clearly. We've accepted this. The acceptance of this is the seeing of it, so to speak. So asserting, yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Now all this creativity that we're engaged in, with all these appearances, trying to make it seem like there's some autonomous process taking place, all that can remain. We just recognize that it's not autonomous at all, and there's no outcome to wait for at all. So we're liberated in the now. Our attention, our whole being is relaxed into the now without waiting for any outcome at all. And so we just enjoy everything that's just happening, realizing that there's no outcome that is ever taking place at all, actually. It's just a dream that we're dreaming. Everything is just equally mere appearance. Everything is just equally non-fixated, mere appearance and pure spaciousness. Arise spontaneously, arising in the now, based on our desire for this to arise. And by us, I mean Spirit, Son of God, with all the creative power of God, God extending itself, is saying God the Spirit. So we have all creative power. So yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing there is no outcome to wait for. So this is how we work on normalizing it for ourselves here. Just keep it very simple. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. So we stay away from the debate, the discussion, the philosophizing, the all the big words and the nitpicking, all this stuff, because we quickly go into either assertion, okay, which is no doubt, yes, this is the form we use. There's several forms, but this is a very basic one. Yes, I already know that there is no outcome to wait for. This is basic, and we can also say, yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. Either way. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome to wait for. This is cut and dried. These are assertions. These are not debating. This is assertion. So we're either asserting, in which there's no question and answer format. We're not asking. We're not giving an answer and asking. We're saying, I know. Yes, I already know. Not that I know. I already know this. I'm just reminding myself what I already know. It's already in place. This knowing is already in place. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there's no outcome to wait for. Absolutely no outcome to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there's absolutely no outcome to wait for. So we're either doing that, or we're full stop in the wow with no conceptuality taking place. So we don't get stuck anymore. We're just catching our breath. We're just catching our spiritual breath. Recognizing that it's just a feeling of elation and trepidation, the continuity fear and the elation, like, wow, I'm so close, I'm so close, I'm so close. Understanding that reality is self-revealed, inherently revealed. We don't have to do anything. Just we have to, all right? We don't have to conceptualize it. It will reveal itself, as it were, when we set our, you know, arrogance down and we see that there's nothing to wait for. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there's absolutely nothing to wait for. No outcome to wait for. There's no outcome to wait for. So full stop in the wow, no conceptuality, and then flipping the script, we are working to point out that there's nothing to wait for. There's no outcome to wait for. We're working on seeing the big picture free of elaboration. Free of nitpicking, free of layers and levels. And what I've been told is that the way to be sane is to focus on sanity, not to try to figure out what's wrong with insanity. Is just focus on sanity. So focus on the big picture. Arrogance. Imagine deal with God. Imagine contest. Imagine outcome of this contest to determine the contest. Imagine that reality suspended itself, so there's an abyss. All this is just imagining. That's it. Those are the basics. So what we do is we try to return to the indisputable, clearly obvious basics, instead of trying to nitpick about different trance states and states of consciousness and is it this, is it that? Can you know this, this? We're not worried about any of that. All of that will take care of itself and clear up of it. Obviously, when we stop misperceiving, we will realize what's always been here, which is perfection. So what I feel is a strong point of this path, this practice, is the wowness of when you're starting to feel overwhelmed by how close you are, you catch it and you're aware of it, and you say, it's a full stop on the wow. And you just do that. That's it. You don't try to dig for answers at this point. You stop conceptuality. You stop your effort. You stop your struggling. Don't struggle with the struggle. You just let it be, and you gradually get used to where you're at. You're recognizing, wow, how close is it if I don't need to wait at all? How close am I? You know, you just start feeling that. It's like, oh my gosh, wow. This is the strength. This is the strength of this practice. So certainly, we're not going to discard the very heart and soul and strength of this practicing. We're not going to get into debates. We're not going to get into discussions. None of that is part of this practice, actually. Because it's very easy to point out the basic parameters of the situation. Okay? At least if you're aware of them. And then the idea is, you know, we want to be aware of these, sure. And then it's very easy to make assertions, and it's very easy to full stop in the wow. It's not a complex situation at all. We're not worried about a bunch of big compound words, dot, 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 you know, like that. And sometimes it's dot, 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 although other groups think it's like dot, 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 and others dot, 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 and there, you know, we haven't quite resolved, is it this or is it that, is it that? Now, when we say the basics, there's no argument about it at all. Our problem is arrogance, period. That's it. I mean, that's the root of these troubles. Our pragmatic fear is a continuity fear. And this has a lot to do with our misbelief that there's an abyss, which comes from our belief that both God and Son of God suspended their reality so we can determine what the real reality is by an outcome. But so we're fear of that, and then we're afraid of, okay, so we don't want to suspend it. Okay, well, let's start it up again. But if we never suspend it, if God never suspended reality, then why does God need to start it up again? There's no startup taking place. There's no startup, but we're frightened of that. You know, so this is a continuity fear. You know, oh, what will I do without my contest and all this? So it's a continuity fear. We're afraid about dropping all all this dream of arrogance and realizing there's nothing to it. There's nothing to it. There's no autonomy to it. What'll I do? We say, what'll I do? How do I judge a winner? How do I judge a winner? How do I know if we're getting to a result? How do I know if I'm getting to an outcome? You see, none of that is taking place. It's like, wow. It's like some continuity issue there, we think. Like, will I feel okay about this? Will I feel okay about this? So we just realize that there is this sensitivity we have. There, underneath all our arguments about this and that, there's a sensitivity and a desire to honor our creativity and a sensitivity to a continuity concern. We have this continuity concern. And so we don't try to hide this by, you know, just trying to use big words to, well, I'm discussing luminous mind, you know, what does that mean or something. No, we don't do that. You know, reality doesn't need to know what reality means. Reality doesn't need an explanation of reality. So we're okay, and reality never stopped. We don't need to start it up again. We don't need to, we're not working on starting it up. I think a lot of this has to do with thinking that we need to understand reality in a certain way so we can get it going again. It never stopped. It never stopped. At all. It never slowed down. God never agreed to any stipulations whatsoever. Now, this work is certainly the work of Jesus. This is what I've gotten from Jesus' help. In A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, it got things, you know, started to simplify, and then I went off and worked just on my own, just simplify, and so it is the work of Jesus helping us simplify this whole situation. And thank God for that, right? Thank God for that, because I've had enough of this complexity of oh my gosh. And we're not here to resolve the debates among the complexities, because what we're saying is there isn't any need for debate. We can just state the simple truth, and the factor we need to deal with is the wow factor. You see, if you don't deal with the wow factor, you're going to be dealing with debates and arguments and controversies and disagreements and struggling with interpretations. Whereas if you do allow yourself the patience of the wowness, you'll find that you just bypass all of that. You don't need it at all. So by using this wow, full stop and the wow technique, you save yourself so much time. You go so fast by doing this. You don't get sidetracked. It's like staying on the freeway instead of taking every exit. Oh, here's an exit. Let me pull off this exit and see what's here. And I'm going to take a little, you know, sort of trip around the area. Now we stay right on the freeway. So it may seem we're going slower because we're not using all our time puffing ourselves up with this, you know, all sorts of intricate debates over, you know, big sounding words, consciousness, mind, luminosity, awareness, this on and on and on in terms of exactly this and exactly that, is it this, is it that. We're not doing that, so we may seem like we're going slower, or not, we're kind of so smart here. But actually, when you get caught up in that, it's very difficult to get back to the big picture. You lose your momentum. But whereas if you just full stop in the wow, you don't lose your momentum, really. You're not conceptualizing anything, and then once you feel relaxed enough in this and comfortable, right back to the big picture. Getting familiar with that. So this is actually the fast approach. Reality doesn't need any ideas about reality. Reality doesn't need any explanation about reality. So we shouldn't even attempt it. We'll just experience it directly. We'll just first see that there's no outcomes to wait for at all. We'll see that. We don't even need the outcome of a debate about reality, do we? See, this is another thing. This is something we've gotten stuck in, is we think that somebody somewhere is determining an outcome for us. Maybe some spiritual genius is working hard or has finally determined an outcome for us. There's no outcome to wait for. There's nothing to be determined. And our fear of the abyss and the continuity fear of maybe having to start up reality makes us say, whoa, wait a minute. And then start getting into level confusion. You said there's no outcome, but you're saying that you're reaching an outcome by no outcome. And now let me, this leads, you know, then before you know it, you know, now you're just all, you know, gone into conceptual confusion. Don't need to do that at all. Just full stop in the wow. Recognize your fear, trepidation, elation and trepidation, which is a sort of a jittery mix. You can feel it, though, the wow factor. You could feel the elation of you say, I think I've got it. I'm seeing it now. Wow. And then say, whoa, what about and full stop in the wow is how you make really fast progress on the path. And ever since I've been using this, since I've been using it consciously, really consciously, and identifying this, the progress has just been extremely fast. Very wowish. Very, very wowish. And before, I was using it all along, I just didn't really identify it so much. And it was a little bit ragged. I wasn't so clear and adamant about using it, you know, like, you know, yeah, just don't. Full stop in the wow. Don't try to struggle with the wow. Just full stop in it. And just trust it will, you'll calm down. Just trust you will calm down a little bit from this reverberation. Just knowing you'll calm down. It was like a faith. I decided, you know what, I'm going to trust this. I'm not going to try to get rid of the wow by thinking about it. I'm just going to let it subside on its own. not struggling to force it to subside. And this was a leap of faith that I took. And along with this already, this practice of already, yes, I know, yes, I already know that I'm already seeing that there is no outcome, absolutely no outcome to wait for. So yes, I already know this. So there's nothing I have to do, attain at all. There's only this continuity fear that needs to be evaporated. And you do this by familiarity, just allowing yourself to get comfortable with this new sense of immediacy. That's a nice word there, immediacy, isn't it? So we tend to let words just sit there by themselves a lot, okay? We don't try to do too much with them. Just feel it, immediacy. And you can just feel, I just feel the wow immediately. I feel a reaction, oh wow. That's a really nice emphasis right there, immediacy. And again, instead of saying, oh, I'm not afraid, say, no, I have a continuity issue. I have a wow reaction to this. So I'm just stopping right there. We've just got a new toy to play with, immediacy. So right in the middle of any sort of what you're doing, if you get this boost, stop right there. Whatever it is you're doing, wherever you're going in your mind, let it just... So we're doing this video and we think, oh, well, I have to keep talking, I have to keep taping. It's just right now, stop. This just hit hard. Immediacy. Don't try to stop this wow reaction by playing with the word of immediacy. What does that mean? Why am I reacting this way? No, it's good. It should be reacting. There's a wow reaction. That's great. Let the wow reaction happen. This is not a slowdown. It's a speed up. We got three huge sporting events taking place in the Bay Area right now. The Golden State Warriors are starting their second round of playoffs at home that they're playing right now. San Francisco Giants are playing the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim right now. Third game of their series, and then the World Golf Match Play Championship is taking place at Harding Park. The finals of Gary Woodland and Rory McIlroy are playing the finals there. And this is all coming to a conclusion right now. And instead of watching that, we're right here taping. We're doing this, I say collectively we, because the viewers are part of, we're all one, actually. So you're, in a sense, taping it also. In an abstract sense. Because it's the will to do this that's at play, right? And the will to do this comes partly from the spirit that I am, and from the spirit that you are. We're all aspects of facets of one spirit. The will to watch it, the will to listen to it, the will to hear it, the will to full stop in the wow. See, that's your contribution to the situation, and that then helps me have the will to actually do it. Now, what's tough is if you don't have many viewers, or it's tough to keep doing it, but I'm somehow able to keep summoning the will to do it. It's not always easy. Even if there's nobody viewing it, I might keep doing it. I don't know, maybe not. that would be tough. So again, the more will you have to hear this, the more it actually you're helping the awakening of everyone. Absolutely. The will to hear it is absolutely a wow, a wowness. Now, in the past, I'd be watching those sporting events, but I just saw a little of them, and I said, just having breakfast, grapefruit juice, that's it. A cup of grapefruit juice, two fresh oranges off our tree, and lime juice and a banana. That's my breakfast, my lunch. That's it. That's what I had yesterday. That'll get you started on a diet right there. I already lost like 3 pounds or something. It just you stop stuffing your face and you immediately lose. You're gonna lose several pounds right away, actually, within a day or so. Doesn't really get off the accumulated fat so much, but at least it makes you feel like you're doing something, and at least you got a chance. So a lot of times there's this drop that happens pretty quickly, and then being a long time dieter out of necessity, because I all my food just goes into fat basically, because my metabolism is so slow. I have to usually I spend like about 4 months out of the year dieting, basically, but this last year was even worse. I've spent the last 6 months. I can't seem to win anymore with it. It's just very tough. And nobody wants to diet continuously. That's what I have to do. If it's just continuously diet, that's not very much fun. I mean, sometimes you want to just stuff your face. That is for sure. So, it's back to grapefruit for me. That seems to work the best, actually. So we're just sitting here after our grapefruit smoothie breakfast lunch and taping on this kind of cool and breezy day here. It's a nice day. And what we're doing now is just full stop in the wow. We've become very trivial. You know, we just talk about the weather or something. Because we're aware that this, what we said about immediacy is just, it hits so hard. We have a new sort of leverage now. I recognize the leverage. Oh my gosh. We can bring this into the mix here. It's like the pedal steel player starting to play. It's, oh wow, this is going to sound nice. Buckle up. Immediacy is in the house. So we're just letting the wow settle down. That's all. And we can do this at any time that you get this, you seem to advance closer to immediacy, to accepting the immediacy of truth, you're going to get this wow reaction. And so whenever you get it, recognize and consciously hold yourself in that wow, where you're not going to try to elaborate upon it. You might call it, non-elaboration, full stop, non-elaboration on it. You can feel the potency of it already, so don't elaborate. Reality doesn't need elaboration upon it. Reality doesn't need explanation, elaboration, answers. Doesn't need to be restarted. So everyone, as they inch closer to accepting the immediacy and not waiting for any outcome whatsoever, the wow reactions are going to arise. There's no doubt about it. No way around it. So it's best to have patience like this. This is what really helps speed you up, because once this settles in and gradually it'll dissipate, then you can go right back to the big picture, and it'll be even clearer than before, because you're not so frightened of it. You say, hey, I got real close to immediacy before, I can just get right back there without it, which shouldn't be a big problem. And you just bypass all this elaboration. And God knows we've done a lot of that in the past. Don't need to do anymore. But I've done so much elaboration. Lifetime of severe elaboration. And gradually getting away from that and realizing that's not it. That is not it. It's a phase. It's a phase you go through. Okay. So it's okay. If you're in that phase, it's okay. But keep in mind that there is this more direct, effective way here to transition back to normalcy. It's just allow the full stop. And the thing is that we're so close to immediacy, we're so close to feeling, oh, I recognize the immediacy, we tend to feel like, I need to run away, let me go escape into my concepts, no matter how spiritual they are. You know, oftentimes we escape into very spiritualized concepts, right? Thinking that that's not really escape, I'm really advancing. No, it's an escape. We're running away. Because the simplicity, this pure simplicity, is the absolute immediacy of no waiting for any result whatsoever, any outcome whatsoever. It's right now, recognizing this. What we want to do is we want to stay close to this recognition. We don't want to retreat into any, it doesn't need any conceptualization. So we want to get used to feeling that we're very close to this, so that feels normal to us. We don't care about elaborate, building some elaborate, you know, citadel of concepts around this. We're not even using elaborate recommendations to not build elaborate conceptualization citadels around it. We're just full stop, and we're not trying to generate any construction at all. We're not building anything at all. Full stop. We're not building a citadel. We're not even laying the cornerstones or the foundation. We're just doing nothing. We're just full stop and say, let me just stop right here for a little while. Let me just feel this wow. Now, as you actually do this, you are going to discover, gradually you'll just start recognizing that this really, really is helpful for you. And that itself is a wow. Because you realize you don't need all these defenses against immediacy. Oh, I don't have, I'm not using them anymore. Wow. There's a huge wow. Oh my gosh. All my delaying tactics, I'm not using them. I'm getting out of practice. Oh my gosh. Wow. I'm not as good as I used to be at diverting myself through clever building mental citadels, spiritual citadels, conceptual citadels, spiritually conceptual citadels of, you know, grandiose explanations. I'm just sitting here quietly like, wow, not doing that. I'm out of shape. Uh-oh. I oftentimes feel like, I sure wish I could come up with some spiritual diversion here, but no, I can't remember what to say. I just have to sit here in the wow. And oftentimes people will come and they say, can you just give me a really good way to divert myself from this wow feeling? You know, some real, it always works great. No, we're the opposite here. We're saying, no, we don't want to divert ourselves from it. But people say, well, I feel uneasy. If I could just divert it a little bit, I'd feel a lot easier. No, of course we're going to feel a little uneasy here as we really get close to accepting the absolute immediacy that is present as reality here and now. We're going to get a little elated and jittery for sure. That's great. immediacy says it all. What do we need to say? Don't need to build any citadels. So when we're struggling, it's often that we're not recognizing the wow. We're trying to struggle with the struggle of the wow. Because when we're flipping the script, it actually goes pretty easily. There isn't all this level confusion, you know, that it's not a struggle, really. It's like more like a brainstorming, like you're looking, you say, oh, I'm seeing this. It's more like a seeing. It's like recognizing what you're seeing. You're not such a struggle. It's not such a struggle. If there's a struggle, it's you're struggling against the wow. We are struggling against the wow if we feel a struggle. Wow, the wind, the breeze is really singing here through all the trees. It's important to realize you're not suddenly, didn't suddenly get off track, which is why your concept's stopping. No, you're so on track that you got the wow feeling. And so have faith that when you allow this to settle down, that it won't be that difficult to get back, you know, get to take a closer look, actually. You have to get a little bit of, give it some effort to look at it for sure. But you're able to do it. So you're able to every day get back to deeper and deeper, deeper, closer and closer to accepting immediacy. Whereas if you ignore the wow, what happens is you go through, the path is like you have bursts of progress, and then you like for two, you know, you'll be off for like two, three weeks or a month or whatever, and you're not able to make much progress, and then you'll have another burst, something will happen here and there. It's very ragged. It doesn't really give you confidence, you know. It goes slowly that way. It fits and starts. Whereas if you consciously insist on practicing this way, you'll find that it's very smooth progress. You feel very smooth. It's not all ragged. It's like a flower blooming, you know, it just opens up like this, very smoothly opens up. You see more and more every day, you see more and more clearly. The bigger picture keeps coming into focus more and more and more. And you just say, wow, I didn't see that before. So it's a day-to-day, you can actually aware that you're actually making progress. Significant, sometimes very significant. Milestones are being passed, you know, all the time. Whereas in a ragged approach, you know, you might hit a milestone this year, and then down the road another milestone, many, many years, and it doesn't have the same smooth, rapid progress. You're not staying, one is not staying on the freeway, but taking the too many exits off. Say, well, I think I'll pull off here and get a bite to eat, you know, and get some coffee and take a rest and all this kind of stuff. Now, you don't really need to do that. It's not advisable. Just keep on everydayness, wow, and having this full stop in the wow gives you confidence that I can do it today. See, if we don't feel we can do it today, we're not going to try. This is something you have to keep in mind, that we're not going to try to do something we feel if we're going to fail at it. We're just not going to do that. We don't want, we say, well, that's a waste of time. So, but if you get confidence in and practice this, wow, full stop on the wow, you will know that you're going to have progress. Like when I sit down, I just have this feeling like, even if I feel totally uninspired, I just know that I'm going to make significant progress. So I'm willing to try. And then, so what happens if you know you're going to make progress, you're willing to try, then you end up trying every day and you make tremendous progress. It's a very positive loop of reinforcement, where if you're just waiting, if you're waiting for an outcome in the world to help boost your ability to be successful on some spiritual path, that's when you get trapped. We're not waiting for any outcome. And if you don't stop in the wow of this, then your path gets ragged and you don't have confidence to start. You say, shall I do it today? No, I don't feel so confident today. You think, what about tomorrow? Well, maybe tomorrow, but you know, maybe I need to wait, you know, until the stars align better. You know, it's like a down cycle in my star chart or something, and I need to wait, you know, until I feel more inspiration. And you know, you may wait a long time and you just sort of feel like, well, I just don't feel like I could succeed that much, so I'm not going to even try. So that's a negative reinforcing loop, very negative reinforcing loop. So if you wonder what's the secret to success, is feeling confident that you're going to succeed. How do you feel confident you're going to succeed? Making rapid progress when you do try. How do you make rapid progress when you do try? By using this full stop in the wow practice here. That generates success, you recognize it, that generates confidence, that generates willingness to try, and that generates even more success and confidence and willingness to try. So I can sit down at any time and feel like I'm going to have a very productive, very helpful time of it, a time very well spent. So of course then I do it. Whereas if it felt otherwise, which in the past I have, I'd say, why should I spend 2 hours grinding my gears in frustration? You know, I'm not going to come up with anything. It's very difficult. I did it anyway, but it was very difficult. This isn't so difficult. And part of the difficulty, a large part, is the continuity fear. We say, I don't want to succeed too fast. You know, I don't think I'm ready for that. So if we're able to just full stop in the wow, then we start trusting ourselves. Say, okay, if it gets too much, I can just stop like this for a while. I won't keep pushing myself, you know, too fast. Like if it feels too fast, I put the brake on a little bit here. That's fine. So we end up being very good spiritual drivers. You know, we know when to use the accelerator, know when to use the brake. Driving on a freeway, we see a slowdown up ahead. We don't say, oh my gosh, I got to bail out the freeway. Let me take the exit here. There's a slowing down up there. Maybe I can go on the side streets and get around the slowdown. And then once you get on the side streets, what happens is you get traffic lights and loop this way and loop this way. Whoops, I can't go to that way. And you waste so much time. Whereas if you got a brake, you see a slowdown on the freeway, you just say, okay, let me brake. Let me slow down a little bit. That's fine. I'll slow down. There's a little bottleneck here. And then it eases up and whoom, you're off again, flying away. And the one that's gone off the freeway on a side trip is, you know, way slowed down. Speaking of going flying on the freeway, people in Silicon Valley are really driving fast on the freeways now. It is just something to behold. You recognize it, actually, that it's speeding up and speeding up and speeding up and speeding up. And I'm actually going faster now than I've ever gone before. I'm saying, whoa, wait a minute, what am I doing? But you feel like, well, what's the big deal? The cars to my left, or they're flying past me. They're going 10 miles an hour faster than I am. I say, well, whoa, wait a minute, though. That's too fast. Let's slow down. It's easy to get pulled into that syndrome. And of course, if they need to slow down, they have a hard time when they're going so fast. So, when we feel the wow, we slow down a little bit here, okay? And we may think, and we stay on the freeway that way. We don't exit the freeway. Traffic's about to go crazy here in the Bay Area because they're building an enormous amount of apartment buildings everywhere. They're terrible. They're doing, they're tearing down old businesses and areas, you know, all over, getting lots, basic a block area, acreage, and throwing up a five-story, you know, apartment-built complex of 100 or, you know, a couple hundred units or whatever. They're stuffing them in everywhere. You know, you got a mom and pop grocery store, gas station, a restaurant, and right next to it is this big apartment complex just popping up. They're just wherever they can, they're throwing them in, and some huge complex is going in. It is just the amount of traffic is going to hit the Bay Area in several years. It is going to bring about gridlock here. Actually, I don't want to be driving here in a couple years. That is for sure. Unfortunately, that's what I do for a living, is driving around, and it's just very stressful. So we'll see what Spirit wants to do, what Spirit wants to do for itself. There's only Spirit here at play. There's no humans here at play at all. It's all Spirit's dream. There's nothing autonomous taking place in the dream. There's no autonomous force called human beings deciding anything at all. It's all Spirit making all choices, all decisions. That includes for these human bodies. It includes the ET bodies. It includes subtle entities. It includes everything. It's all Spirit that's deciding everything. That's choosing everything. It's doing everything here. There's nothing autonomous taking place here. Anywhere. There's nothing autonomous taking place anywhere. Now, someone might come from far away and say, "Help, help, I need spiritual help." And we spend all our time full stop on the wow. We just say one thing, immediacy, and boom, stop. And they may think, well, I spent all this money traveling, coming here, how much time? Tell me more. It's learning the full stop and the wow. That's the most important aspect that anyone can ever learn. Is the confidence to say, whoa, wait a minute, let me slow down a little bit here. This is getting very close. The immediacy of reality is starting to dawn upon me. Wow. If you don't slow down for that, you're not going to slow down for anything, right? I mean, it's not justified. This is the big one. That's all there really is to see, is the immediacy of reality. There's no outcome to wait for. There isn't any contest taking place. Part of the trouble is Spirit believing, you know, that it has to win, have this outcome go favorably for it. And when it tries to speak here in this world is so demanding of this idea of an outcome that confirms Spirit's belief that reality is imperfect and that there's something autonomous separate from reality, that Spirit gets caught up in trying to prove that it can win. And so the Spirit may have the body engage in all sorts of competition and efforts to win in this way or that way, whether it's win a game or win a better, a richer spouse, you know, a more successful relationship, or win in this way and win in that way. I'm winning I got better clothes, I look better, more attractive than you, all this kind of stuff. You know, Spirit gets caught up in playing in this way, thinking that there's something that needs to win. There's no winning. There's no outcome that we need to wait for. There's nothing, no outcome at all. all is immediate. There's only immediacy of reality. And so when spirit starts to recognize that it becomes less interested in winning, even in subtle ways. You know, the obvious way, you talk about the football players wanting to win the football game, and you know, the kind of macho men thing of winning, you know, competitive. But there's all sorts of other types of competition of winning taking place. Winning, I have a better house. Winning, we're in a better neighborhood. Winning, our children are going to a better school. Winning, our children are getting better grades. You know, winning, we're going on vacation. You know, winning, I have a nicer kitchen. Winning, we're eating healthier food. Winning, see, all this is this idea of winning. Winning, spirit doesn't need to win anything. There's nothing up for grabs. There's no outcome up for grabs. There's no outcome to be determined. There's no competition. There's no competition taking place. There's nothing to be determined. There's nothing autonomous. There's nothing autonomous taking place. So there's nothing to be determined. The outcome of autonomy is not something to be determined. There isn't any taking place at all. So when you practice this full stop and the wow and really keep doing it and get, you will look back, and you may even not look back, you don't even need to, but you just realize, wow, I'm so further along now than just a year ago. I can't even describe it. And don't even need to look back. It's too much. Water under the bridge is so much. And people, spirits at play with arrogance, wrongly believe that the spirits who are repentant are somehow winning, and that they're going to win, and the spirits that are arrogant are saying, wait, I'm not ready to win yet. We're not ready for this outcome. They think that if you're enlightened, you got the outcome somehow for yourself. And they say, well, I'm not ready to get that outcome yet. You know, we're not quite ready. There is no outcome to get. There's no winning taking place. That's all that fear is, a misinterpretation. There's no losing either taking place. There's no winning or not winning. There's never been any autonomy taking place. Pow. Uh-oh. I'm going to have to just, okay. I'll have to say taping. So, let's see if I can do this. There you go. Resend tape. Okay. And we're not bothered, but we're trying to stay in this wow, full stop in the wow. We got really getting our bell rung here for sure. Uh-oh. I'll just have to send the... I'm not going to... resend taping at it. So that does affect the wow. It does affect it a bit. Yeah, I get kind of like start thinking about, well, what do I need to do to produce an outcome? You start getting to outcome consciousness. Whereas in full stop in the wow, we're trying to get free of outcome consciousness, outcome concern. We allow our attention to be free of this pressure of outcome concern, outcome fear. And then when we get pressured to do stuff, to act and get outcomes, that sort of pulls us out of the concentration for sure. Even getting the outcome of like a well body, that's outcome too, right? Happiness, wealth, all those positive outcomes, that's just as much outcome consciousness, you know, as anything else. Avoiding troubles. There isn't anything to be determined at all. And this is what we have to accept as our primary recognition. There isn't anything to be determined. There's no contest taking place. And then once this is realized, then we don't need to give the appearance of an outcome. So everything can be aligned flawlessly with that purpose. Everything will flawlessly align itself with that purpose in terms of our appearancing and functioning without us trying to generate an outcome. So maybe we've done enough. Maybe the call was just to help us realize that we've done enough and that we've covered the territory that we wanted to cover here, which is keep emphasizing full stop in the wow. We've got a lot of clarification, simple clarification. And so just trust in that. Just trust in the wow. When the wow arises, trust in it. Trust that you've really gotten into some very, very clear recognition. So we'll trust this for a little while. Maybe later we'll do another taping. Like that. Okay. Let's play it that way. It's an hour and a half anyway right now, so that's great. All right, very great. That's it for this one. Supposed to be it. Let's see. Let's see if it's working. Okay.